Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined, yes, you can see two guests, which always goes well when I do these interviews. I'm joined by one of the fastest growing tag teams in Scottish wrestling right now. It's Brody Turnbull and Jake Lawless. It's Arcade Violence. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having us, Billy. Nice to be here.
I'm excited to have you guys on. Like I was saying just before we recorded, it's just excited to have you on because you're pretty much are the one of the most exciting tag teams right now. There's a good group of tag teams coming up all over the country from where I am, Northeast and down in the Central Belt as well. There's a good array of different kind of teams. So it's good to have you guys on. How's it going today?
I think I can speak for you as well, Brody, when I say we're both pretty sore today.
Yeah, bit of a stiff one last night.
Aye. Brody's got a bad arm. I've got a bad hand. We had a bit of a war with the young team, not for the first time. And unfortunately came away on the losing end of that. Again, not for the first time. So we're licking our wounds a little bit today. But, you know, we regroup and reset and go at it again.
So for those unaware, because there'll be sometime in September, this has just been recorded the day after ICW Fight Club. So the match, I'm assuming it'll already be out on Fight Plus. If it's not, then something's gone very wrong at someone's end. Yeah, so quite a war, which we'll definitely touch on, because I've got a list of kind of your opponents-ish, and young team crops up quite a lot in different promotions. So we'll definitely get onto that. Let's go right back to the start then. The most cliched question you're ever going to get asked on a podcast is how you got into wrestling. So who wants to take it first?
Brody, I'll let you go first, man.
Yeah, for me, goes back to 2019. I was pretty heavy. I weighed 24 stone and I wasn't in shape, but I was a big wrestling fan. So at the end of 2019, I flew out to Japan for the January 4th show in Tokyo. Always were a big fan of Japanese wrestling, so I decided I would head out there for that show. And it was in that show I decided that I wanted to make a shot at becoming a wrestler. So I came home, started working out, got into shape, and then started wrestling. Pretty much it.
You make it sound all so easy from that point. I just went to Japan, became a wrestler. It's fine. and Jake, we'll go back into like how you became a fan, but yeah, for yourself, how did you get into wrestling as well?
Yeah, so for me it was, again, I've been a fan since the age of maybe 9 or 10. I remember when I got into my late teens, early 20s, it was always a little thing at the back of my mind, you know, sort of what if, like, could I do it? Could I give that a go? And I always dismissed it as this pretty stupid fantasy. And then ended up spending most of my 20s in music. But I came back to Scotland, and then in the first major COVID lockdown, that voice at the back of my head about wrestling was just getting louder and louder and louder. And I think, like a lot of people during that first major lockdown, when everything came to a halt, I think a lot of people reevaluated how they were spending their time and what they were doing with their life and what direction they were going in, blah, blah, blah. And then one night I watched the documentary You Cannot Kill David Arquette, and that was the trigger. Like, about an hour after I watched that documentary, I sent an email out to a couple of wrestling schools. I actually knew very little about the scene at that point, so I sent an email out to a couple of different schools, and then eventually a couple got back to me, and one thing led to another, and then I went for my first one-to-one meeting with Wolfgang at Iron Girders Gym, with the intention of just getting good enough to wrestle one match, and then I could tick it off the bucket list, and then it just became way, way more than that. Sort of snowballed, and then and here we are, basically. But very long story short, it's all down to David Arquette.
There you go. There's the quote for the episode. I'll come back to that. So Brody, so we spoke about you went to Japan and to see a show, thought that's it, I'm going to become a wrestler, get fit. Was it always Japanese wrestling you got into, or was it WWF or WWE? I don't know how old you guys are. I'm assuming way younger than I am. But what was your kind of nucleus for getting to be a fan of the wrestling itself?
So no, it was back in the late 90s for me as a
Okay.
kid. Yeah, into WCW mainly. And then when WCW folded, started watching WWF.
Right, okay. So
That's
was
when
it
I started.
worldwide or when Cartoon Network shut off and became TNT?
I just remember watching, was it Channel 4 or 5? I remember watching it on a Friday night, I
Channel
think.
5,
On
yeah.
Channel 5, yeah. I think it may have been like a condensed episode. They didn't show the full episode of Nitro. It was like kind of cut. It was like, you know, the edited shows they do.
Yeah, I remember.
It was really edited. I just got into wrestling through that. Loved Sting, loved Goldberg, all the usual guys when you're a kid. And then, you know, my kind of most intense memories of early wrestling is probably from the Invasion angle. That's when I was really starting to become aware of, you know, what wrestling really was. So kind of that time period, I've got really fond memories of, yeah.
That's it. I mean, people they don't like Invasion for whatever reason, but sue for yourself as well. That's when I started getting to know these people, because I was 11
Yep.
when Invasion happened. So that's when I was seeing all new faces, all this cool wrestling, and it's
Yeah,
all a
absolutely.
nice little nostalgia point. I mean, I didn't care that I didn't see Sting, because I'd only seen Sting on Worldwide. Even then,
Yeah.
it was the big Batman kapow things when the chair shot happened. So, you know, I wasn't.
Yeah, I've got very fond memories of when NWO went to WWF as well. I thought that was cool at the time.
Yeah, I think I agree with that as well. The Invasion nowadays, obviously, in hindsight, gets kind of slated. But at the time, watching it, even though it wasn't the big WCW names, it felt massive to me. It felt like a really big deal, you know.
That's it. I'm sorry, I missed a little bit of that, but I'll get it when can you hear me okay? Just because my headset died.
Yeah, we've got you. Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah, we're just saying to both of us, the Invasion angle is something we remember fondly.
Right, someone's determined not to be able to hear the story. Hang on. Oh, I love technology. Right, okay, I'm just gonna just change to this snazzy headset instead. But we do keep these in because I hate editing. Right, hang on, microphone. There we go. Hear me all right?
Yeah, we've got you.
Excellent. Right, cool. Leave this here for the aesthetic. Right, yeah. That's what we're saying. Yeah, the Worldwide Invasion was all cool because we got to see all these new faces. We'll move on from that, because I think that some out of worldly thing is determined for me not to hear that story. Right. Okay. So there we go. Excellent. Right. Moving on then. So there's the one then. There's two. Jake, was it about the same time for yourself? Again, I'm terrible with ages. Was that around about the same time for you?
Well, I think we're probably about the same age, man. It was about 99 I started watching properly. Unlike Brody, though, I was just straight in with WWF. So I had watched at a friend's house a couple of like VHS tapes of WCW PPVs. I was aware of it as an entity, mm-hmm. but I found WWF for whatever reason was like way more accessible for me. So yeah, it was about 1999, and then it's been almost constant ever since that I sort of dipped. I think like a lot of people our age experience, like I kind of dipped out of watching it for a little spell. You begin to relate less to the product or to the wrestlers on TV and things. And now I watch more wrestling than I ever have before. So yeah, fully back into it.
And what's amazing when you were talking about like just not being aware of the Scottish scene, which, I mean, if everyone is aware, they should go to swnscotland.com. But if you were aware of the Scottish scene at the time, so you wouldn't have known about Wolf, wouldn't known too much about Wolfgang being in NXT UK, and they would have just been kind of in that kind of realm, just about NXT or his reputation in Scotland. So you would have went in with fairly fresh mindset of no starstruckness about him.
I think that's kind of fair. Like, I was aware of a few names because of NXT UK, and I was obviously aware of ICW. In fact, I was living in Leeds when ICW toured and played. I think ICW put an event on at the O2 in Leeds while I was living there. I was aware of ICW and that whole story and what they'd achieved and the Hydro stuff, and was fully aware of that. But in terms of the I would say, like, in terms of the infrastructure of the Scottish scene, I had no idea. Like, I didn't know about the schools. I didn't know who was coaching and how accessible that was. But I was aware of Wolfgang. But the first time that I went to Girders for my very first one-to-one with him, it was in just that little first window where the COVID lockdown was relaxed a little bit. So he came to the door, he had a beanie hat on and he had a mask. I had no idea it was him until about halfway through, and then he mentioned something about NXT and then it just clicked and I was like, oh, all right. And all of a sudden felt the pressure level escalate substantially. But yeah, I was aware of the bigger names and all the ICW stuff, but in terms of the grassroots stuff and the infrastructure, I didn't really have a clue.
So for yourself, Brody, you said you just, once you came back from Japan, you went, right, I'm going to find a school. Was it Girders straight away? Did you dabble with anywhere else nearby, or was it always Girders that you found?
I had a good look about, and from what I could tell, the kind of better schools were in Glasgow City Centre. So I applied to GPWA first, but because of the COVID lockdown, they had nothing running, they couldn't run anything. So they sent us to Iron Girders, and I did my first one-to-one through Iron Girders. And my first one-to-one was with Jack Jester, who was actually coaching there, very briefly. And sort of similar thing to Jake. I got there, he came to the door wearing a hat, wearing a mask, but I had no idea who it was because you don't tell you who your coach is going to be. And then I was in the ring and it was really strange. You couldn't really do anything with anyone. You just had to work on your roles and kind of wrestling fundamentals and things like that. And there was one point he took his mask off and I was like, whoa, I kind of realized who it was that was taking me for a lesson. I was similar to Jake, I was fairly aware of ICW. I was aware of the success. I knew the kind of main wrestlers there, but I didn't know too much about the kind of wider Scottish scene.
Yeah. Okay, so it's quite good that you guys pretty much had the same, not only in your watching of wrestling, but your actual coming into wrestling is very similar, very mirrored.
Similar to Jake as well. Through my 20s, when I kind of fell out of wrestling, I was also heavily involved in music and a band as well. So we've got very, very similar lives.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it just makes all the sense in the world that you guys were either paired together, or was it just a case of you were put together and it seemed to work, or did you guys get chatting about music, about your interests, and suddenly you were like, okay, this guy, I could probably do something with.
I guess, yeah. Like early sessions, we started to identify with each other as having like similar interests, and obviously being very close in age. In an environment where the majority of guys were younger than us starting out. Not a lot of people start at the age that Brody and I have. And we were training together a lot in Iron Girders. And it was actually Wolfgang who first planted the idea of Brody and I starting a tag team. And he's not a man whose advice and recommendations you ignore. So I went for it, and then the rest is history.
It is, because when you guys kind of burst onto the scene, I've watched too many Michael Richards TikToks, it seems, but when you guys burst onto the scene, it was, you're very much a well-established team, as in presentation-wise. You were kind of matching gear, you did promos together. It wasn't like it was two separate guys that were kind of coming together. You were just a team as you entered. When you found out that, well, when you're kind of getting paired together through Wolfgang, did you consciously look for like tag team inspiration or anything like that, or was tag teams stuff you were interested in before even being a team?
Yeah, as soon as Wolfgang suggested it, and we discussed the idea and we started taking it seriously, we were all in. You know,
yeah,
we were a team. It wasn't just two guys that were together for convenience. So we went all in and we planned for a long, long time, maybe 8-9 months before you ever seen us. We were planning everything, every single thing that you see us present to you on social media, at shows. It's all carefully created by us.
Yeah, absolutely. And also add into the fact that we're being mentored by a guy like Wolfgang, who's had incredible. Tag teams had incredible tag team success. It sort of and recently on sort of pretty much the highest level as well. So there wasn't really a better guy to go through those tag team fundamentals with. And then to touch on your other point, Billy, I think to an extent, yeah, like I'd always looked up to tag teams. I'd always been really into tag teams when I started watching wrestling. New Age Outlaws were one of my favourite things on television for that spell that they were like really at the top. And I remember when I first started getting into WWF, how big a deal the likes of, you know, New Age Outlaws, Hardys, Dudleys, Edge and Christian tag team wrestling when I first started watching was absolutely massive. And I certainly make a conscious effort now to watch as much of it as I can for learning purposes. But yeah, so it's really a mix of both.
You mentioned New Age Outlaws there, and I don't know what it is when I see your kind of promo style, because Jake, you're very much the talker. You're the guy that has the way with the words, and yourself, Brody, you kind of just stand in the back and look menacing. There was a kind of, in his weirdest way, when I saw you guys, there was a New Age Outlaws kind of vibe there, and I couldn't put my finger on it totally, because of course it's not Road Dogg and Billy Gunn. It's a different kind of thing, but the dynamic seems to be kind of similar in the same vein. But yeah, we brought up New Age Outlaws. That just makes all the sense in the world. And we're when it comes to tag team wrestling, because that's when I got into wrestling as well. So it just, take that out. There we go. Right. So yeah, it's just absolutely perfect to bring that up. So from that point onwards, Arcade Violence, how did that come about? The name itself.
I think it was you, Brody, that we sort of threw a few names around, and I believe you put forward Arcade Violence.
Yeah, so there was a method I used, which I actually got from a band called Cancer Bats, who people might be familiar with. And this band, Cancer Bats, what they did was they had two bags. And they had one bag with a name of diseases and one bag with names of animals in them. So I did something similar, and I had two lists of different words that were kind of around things we were interested in, you know, other things we discussed, and Arcade Violence was what we settled on.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of works, because you can do, there's so many ways you can take from with AV Club as well, with the hand motions as well, because you can.
That stuff was actually kind of coincidental. That was just pure luck, the AV Club thing and the hand signal. We'd been obviously training for a long time, and we're trying to figure out things we can do when we enter the ring to make a statement, and that just came about just by total chance. Total chance.
Yeah, it kind of, like, it made the name sort of meant to be, you know, that it sort of immediately felt, first of all, it immediately felt that it suited us really well. Like how the arcade aspect of it sort of is a little nod towards our generation and a bit of a throwback, which is what we like to mirror our style of tag team wrestling on. It's a little bit of a throwback, and then the fact that stuff started to come so easily, like we say, like the hand sign and the AV Club and everything, it just sort of made it feel like the name was definitely meant to be. We settled on the right one.
And I think the violence part of it, if I remember right, I think I wanted to use the word violence, but one of my favourite tag teams ever is Medical Violence Connection. And I thought it'd be really cool to kind of have a very tiny nod towards them.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we talked about the interest in both music, both in bands as well. So, I mean, if things had gone any other way, it could have been kind of that kind of related, but it's more a case of like I said, I like that. I never thought about it being arcade, being of our generation, of going out and getting the big arcades up and hanging about and maybe bullying, not me personally, but bullying folk off arcades and stuff and causing issues and violence. And that's a thinker. That's a thinker that I've realized it's become there. But yeah, so talk about your music then. Both bands, I'm an old man when it comes to music. I like easy listening, bit of pop. That's all I've got. So I'm assuming it's a bit more heavier than that. But yeah, what was your music style?
Well, Brody, you were way heavier than that, weren't you?
Yeah, I was a guitarist in a stoner metal band. Yeah, and it's pretty much the beginning and end of what we were. We just dressed in black and played heavy music.
I was the lead singer and second guitarist of a sort of alt rock band. Probably most heavily influenced by people like Incubus and stuff like that. That was when I was living down in Leeds for about 5 years, about almost 6 years. So I don't remember all of it, but what I do remember was pretty fun.
Right. Okay. I'm getting the vibe of this. Yeah. So, any thoughts to bring that into our entrance at some point? Are you waiting for just a big stadium show, a big arena show before you guys get the guitars back out and do your own entrance?
That's an interesting thought. I don't know. I mean, I don't know about you, Brody. I think my guitar is at least semi-permanently retired, I think. Largely because I keep messing up my hands fighting people. But yeah, no, I don't know. I think that the music related stuff is just for my ears only from this point on, I think.
Yeah, I think I'm done with that now as well. It was fun. It is a lot of fun. I would recommend anyone to do it if they're interested in it, but I'm past it now as well. I've sold all my guitars. I'm very much kind of the belief that someone should be playing them, so sold them all off.
Absolutely.
Fair.
I think it's like it with what we are aiming for in wrestling and the work that Brody and I have put in so far, like up to this point, it doesn't, in all honesty, leave a lot of room for much else. Obviously there's always real life going on and that has to be navigated, but to use the cliche, like it is very much eat, sleep, and breathe pro wrestling. There's not a lot of space for anything else at the moment.
Yeah, it's an industry that does consume your entire life, if you're taking it anyway seriously at all.
I can sympathize with that. I'm not even the one getting punched. I'm just at the end writing stuff and typing stuff and all that kind of thing and doing this as well. It's you don't realize even at this kind of minor level for myself anyway, it does consume so much, and where you guys have to keep yourself healthy and make sure that you're eating right and trying to make sure you're doing unique stuff and or taking older stuff and try and make it new. It's I can't imagine a wrestler's brain going just haywire 100% 365. It's just madness. So we talked about how you got into training. We talked about how you became a tag team. So let's get to the debut then. So it was about, as this goes out, about a year ago. I think it was, I've got September 2022. Whether you guys did any shows around then, like galas or showcases or anything. But I've got your debut September 2022 as a team. What were your thoughts getting told you were going to have a match in front of a crowd, and how you think of the match itself?
I'm pretty happy with the match as far as I can remember. I've not thought about it for a long time. I feel like I'm sure you'll be the same, Brody. I feel like we would maybe watch it now and look like or feel like we're watching different people.
Yeah, I enjoyed the match. Yeah, it was good fun. The Angerders crowd is always pretty loud. We're facing one of their favourites in Martin McAllister. It was Mark McAllister and Jan Slavic won. So yeah, it went well. We got the victory, so no complaints.
I really like Iron Girders' setup and shows. I've seen a couple of them on YouTube now, and it's there's a really rabid crowd and a really good dedicated crowd as well. Was that the first IGPW show? That was it, or
No, I think that was six or seven.
the first one was the first one Scotty Too Hotty?
No, and Eric Young.
Oh, that's right, Eric Young. Aye, and that would have been, I think, March of that year, February or March of that year.
Yeah,
I would say so,
a good host would have had that information in front of me, but H Match just has it as IGPW. I know that's not right. They number them now, So I mean, that's still a dedicated crowd. So they're up for seeing some wrestling. That's pretty much the vibe I get from watching it online. They like to be introduced to new faces and see what they're like. So Yeah, like I say, you had your match against Yanis Lavikbun and Martin McAllister, very big fan favourites. So does that kind of make was that pressure off you a little bit in that first match? Because you knew that everyone loved Martin anyway. You could just be bad bastards for 10 minutes.
I guess it was a little bit. It's also... it's also the fact that by that point we were already so comfortable working in Iron Girders, like not necessarily in front of a crowd, but that was very much our home from home. So I think that was a big deal at the time. And also going in against two guys who were not a natural tag team made us pretty confident that we would come out on top even at that early stage. So that was also a bonus. But
we were pretty angry going into that match as well. In the show before, Jake wrestled Martin McAllister and Martin McAllister broke Lawless's hand. So we had a score to settle on that one.
We did have a score to settle. So yeah, that was that.
Interesting you said about going against Jan and Martin not being an actual team. I'm speaking to an episode that hasn't gone out yet as we're recording with Stephen Air Miles of Fair City Saints. Mm-hmm. And he was pointing out that it's so different when you're facing two guys that are put together, and then it becomes like a walk, not a walk in the park, but it becomes so much smoother when you're facing guys that are an actual tag team. So quite early on, you were in the ring with the young team, who it's a sore point at this point because this is the day after Fight Club. But
yeah,
they teamed up a lot more. So did you find there was a difference going in the ring with a team that had more cohesive moves, had a move set that was more suited to tag team wrestling? And find it was a bit more enjoyable even to wrestle in?
The thing about, I mean, I don't know if I would use the word enjoyable in talking about the young team, but the thing about them is that although, yeah, they are the young team, they are young guys. A lot of people maybe don't realise that in spite of that, they've been doing this for, what, like a decade, Brody?
I think Logan has wrestled for a decade, yeah.
Aye, for a decade. So, I mean, they have experience. They have an experience level already at their age that a lot of people who go into this never actually reach. And the thing about the young team is they have that experience level, but because of their age, they're so quick as well. They're like, they're almost like a cheat code in that respect, because you shouldn't have that. You shouldn't still have that pace, that speed of movement, but also have that experience level. But because they started so ridiculously young, they do have it. That's where we found the challenge in facing them. People might look at us on the poster against the young team and think we're the most experienced team. We're actually not at that point yet. We're more experienced in life. We're more grizzled. We're a bit more rough around the edges, but the young team have the experience and the pace. And up until this point, they've continued to get the better of us. In terms of like dealing with the chemistry, it's starting to, as we have more and more matches, and I don't know if you'd agree with this, Brody, it is starting to, the feeling being in the ring against two single guys that have been put together and then going in with an established tag team, like the feeling is getting further and further apart. It is a wildly, at least for me, it is a wildly different experience.
When you've got two singles in there, you can fluster them really easily. They don't really know what to expect when they face a tag team that cares about being a tag team. We use each other, you know, to our own benefit. When you're facing a team like the young team, you have to be careful because they're always looking for that tag. They're always trying to get the fresh man in. When you're facing two singles, they don't have that instinct. And that's something you can manipulate very easily.
You also have to, like, I don't think anyone would argue that anyone who goes into pro wrestling, and not also the fact that we've been in like music, it's a similar industry in this sense. There's always going to be like a little bit of ego that you're trying to feed all the time. And whether that's with like a bit of arrogance in the ring in an isolated moment, or whether it's about getting the win, there's that little bit of ego you're trying to feed. But when you go into being an established tag team, you learn to kind of put that to one side, and it becomes instead about the collective ego of the tag team. Two singles guys who have been put in a team together for a match, they don't have that. They have the two separate egos, and they can sometimes sort of clash and work against each other. and you're not really looking out for your partner in the same way, or like Brody says, you're not looking out for that tag, you're not immediately thinking, oh, this guy's here to help. So it becomes really easy to break them up in the ring, you know?
If something happens to one of us, we're both out of work. So we have to look after each other, whereas two singles don't have that to worry about.
Yeah, for sure.
I suppose when you look at the facility you have available at Iron Girders, of course you have Wolfgang, who a lot of his stuff will be kind of over video now because of being NXT. But when you look at the rest of the team there that operate in Iron Girders or host classes there, you've got BT Gunn, who is infamous as a tag team wrestler with like Stevie Xavier and what have you.
Yep.
So he's got that experience. You got Jester, who's been a tag team champion with the likes of Shaw Samuels, and I think he was champion with Wolfgang for a bit somewhere as well. And then even with that, you've got Luke King Sharp, who hosts once a week, who's had many tag team exploits and has such an amazing brain for wrestling. It's you're probably one of the best places when it comes to tag team wrestling to learn, because you have so many people that have, and Molly as well, Molly Spartan, who does a bit there as well as part of the She-Wolves. So it seems to be, if you wanted to do tag team wrestling, Girders seems to be a good spot to try and get into and pick up a thing or two at.
I genuinely don't think there's a better school in the world for tag team wrestling. With where Wolfgang is, who he is being coached by, you know, that's directly getting fed to us, whether it's by video call, whether it's by message. You mentioned Stevie Boy, he was also a coach in Iron Girders for a while. Kaylee Ray was also a coach in Iron Girders for a while. And obviously BT Gunn, he's the main man there now, and he's a magician when it comes to all kinds of wrestling. He is an incredible coach, and obviously he's maybe in the most famous Scottish tag team within the Scottish scene in NAK of all time. So he's a hell of a
fan
from as well.
He's just above all else legitimately a world class talent. It's he's utterly ridiculous. And also you've got Kez Evans at Iron Girders, and him and BT have their axe to grind with ICW and are teaming up together in order to do that. So they're also, they've sort of just become instantly one of the most formidable tag teams in the country because of their individual talent, but now they're putting it together and working as a team.
And Iron Girders posted the other day about the tag teams, the tag team division, and they mentioned KOE also train at Iron Girders.
Yep.
Those guys don't get enough credit for who and what they are as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And a team that we've not faced yet, but I'm sure that we will at some point down the line, and that'll be a really interesting match. But like Brody said, it's also the fact that Wolfgang just has a respect for tag team wrestling that maybe not every wrestling coach has, and that's filtered all the way through Iron Girders, which has made a huge difference.
So, as a coach as well with Wolfgang, he takes his coaching role very seriously, which is something worth mentioning. Even in his current position, we still hear from him after every match. He'll ask how it goes, you know, give us feedback. He watches the matches back. His coaching is absolutely, absolutely invaluable to us.
I was seeing the photos going up of people just appearing on the hard cam that was getting video called through to Wolfgang. It's just, even however many miles away, at least more than 10 miles away, he's able to keep an eye on you guys and give you a little bit of feedback, which, like I say, is invaluable. We mentioned all those tag teams, though. We mentioned all those teams, but there's one team you didn't mention, and I think this is a very important team in your relatively short career so far that we need to make mention of, and it's Rabo Romero and Mikey Devine of Casino Brutal.
Did we not mention Casino Brutal? That's terrible, man.
That's not like us not to mention them.
They will not be happy, but are they ever? So. You guys kind of, I was enjoying your work and everything. I really enjoy Casino Brutal's kind of promo work, and as I'm enjoying you guys as well, as I see it, because I think social media is such an important thing for not only fans to go in, but for me as well, because I don't know who you guys are unless I see a promo video. That's pretty much it. But Deadpool Danger. was an amazing concept, but unfortunately, you guys drew the short straw on it. So Deadpool Danger, Brody, you were the one who got pinned and had to change the name. Yeah, thoughts on the actual concept, the match, and just how did you come up with a new name?
Jake mentioned Ego earlier on, and I think Deadpool Danger was a match where maybe my ego went a bit too far, and I paid the price for that. You know, I suggested a stipulation, and left up to Casino to decide, and that's what they chose.
We had Casino originally wanted to make the stipulation that whoever got pinned would have their new name chosen for them by the winning team, but we had to we contacted Wolfgang and we said that we absolutely refused to agree to that stipulation. We were confident that we were going to get the win. That was foolish, but there was no way we were letting two absolute jackasses choose what either one of us was going to be called moving forward. So there's a sad moment, but we move on. And now Jake Lawless and Brody Turnbull, that's Arcade Violence, and that is what we are known as, and it's worked out as a much better fit. So I guess the joke is on Casino, as it often is.
So did you get the two pots out again and show and had first name, last names, and just picked it from there?
Kind of, yeah. Something like that. Although I will say that night, we learned a lot about Casino that night, and I feel like we've righted those wrongs since, but it was Mikey Devine that pinned me, and I learned with Mikey Devine, never count that guy out. He will fight until he can't move.
I think you see that really clearly in our match with them at the Shug's house party pre-show. Mikey Devine would just not... I mean, we were laying into that guy for relentlessly for what felt like a lifetime, and he just would not stop getting up. And then when he does get to Rabu, and Rabu comes in, and he's quick, and he hits hard... that was actually a bit of a brutal match. The young team ended up taking advantage of the fact that we'd gone through that before our title match with them. So it's been a pretty bruising, 8 days? 7 or 8 days?
Yeah.
Well, that's where I was kind of leading to eventually with Casino Brutal. Rabu has asked in the Twitter comments here, just asking them why him and Mikey were tagged in this post, and this is why, because I think they're, along with them and the young team, they're a very important tag team to your first 12 months in developing as a unit. But you had a match in the pre-show of ICW Shug's House Party. So previously you'd been on some asylum, a couple of asylum tapings, or just at least one asylum taping So you've been a few asylum tapings. People would have known in the crowd generally who you were, but this is your first, and obviously it being on Fight Club Plus as well, Fight Plus, whatever, very confusing. But Shug's House Party 8 against Casino Brutal, number one contendership match in the pre-show. That's like one of the first or second match of the night in a big kind of pay-per-view extravaganza for ICW. You know, we talk about pressure. You say no ego between you and all that. It must be a little bit of extra pressure on that kind of night with a bigger crowd in the garage, a famed venue for ICW.
Yeah, I don't know if Brody and I fully, like, we knew obviously it was a big deal. I don't think anyone fully understands what that is like, walking out at an ICW event at the garage. You can't fully know what it's like until you walk through that entranceway. It was just a totally different level from what we've experienced so far. It is a special place. How did you compare it, Brody? You said it was like the Scottish wrestling's equivalent to
Yeah, so we were going over the match with Wolfgang, and I said it's the Scottish equivalent of the Corican Hall in Tokyo. It is a special, special place for wrestling in Scotland. It's a large venue, it's a beautiful venue, and it's set up. And you know, the pressure of that moment is pretty intense.
Yeah, having the people up on the people up in the balcony, it's just, it adds a totally different dimension.
And the people backstage as well watching, I mean, it's not lost on us. You know, people like Damo are backstage watching those monitors. You have to prove that you belong on a card with someone like that. And that's a lot of pressure.
That's right, yeah. Along with the usual, like, Mark Dallas, Jack Jester, Rudo's back there, you know, all the current champions. Yeah, it was quite something. We were, we did our job on the night, or we did our job in that match. But it's not something that we will forget soon. And it's also, it's a pretty addictive feeling. Once you've experienced that once, you know that that's where you want to be back at, you know. So that's what we've got to work towards.
And then from that point, you appeared on the actual main show itself, because Bungard and Paul Craig had to relinquish titles for whatever reason. Rudo came out with the belts, and somehow, some way, you ended up in a match with the Young Team for the titles itself on a big event for ICW. So be your first kind of, however they call it, pay-per-view, PLE. Again, in a title match, big pressure, big moment. So not only did you have your first match at the Garage, but you also had your second on the same night. So licking your wounds coming into it, and then obviously Young Team taking advantage to it. Was that a moment where you thought Arcade Violence had made it as a team, or did you have that feeling beforehand? Where was your kind of mindset as a team at that point?
Well, I think there was maybe a bit of, again, I go back to ego, there was maybe a bit of ego, a bit of naivety through sort of being less experienced. I think after that casino match, which was a bit of a battle, obviously we're on top of the world, we've become number one contenders, this freak opportunity opens up, and I just picked up the microphone and we went out and took that chance. We had as much of a right to be in a title match than anyone else after that match with Casino Brutal. But hindsight, yeah, maybe going into a title match against the Young Team when they're fresh and we're not operating at 100%. Maybe that was bravado, a little bit foolish. It's a massive learning curve. And I don't know, in terms of whether like we feel like we've made it, I feel, I don't know if you'd agree, Brody, I think we feel like we are at the level that we want to be at right now, but we're sort of just beginning to scratch the surface, I think, in the overall sense.
Yeah, I don't think this is just level one, so to speak. We've barely begun. We still feel like we're finding ourselves, finding our feet in this industry.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, I think we've done well to be where we are at this point after only 10, 11 months. But no, I don't think we've made it yet. Also, I heard a rumor backstage at Shugs that the reason Paul Craig and Chris Bungard didn't show up is because we won the number one contender match. I don't know if that's true, but that's what I heard.
Yeah.
Wouldn't surprise me at all now with their fake fighting. So from why am I picking fights with them? From that point onwards, so Young Team, that kind of match, Shugs, is your kind of mini boss to start off with, and then you recover and recuperate and ride again. And another company that you're working with or will be working with, you made a couple appearance at Pro2 already for Brew Station at the time. That was back in March. A homecoming of sorts for you guys as a team, and you're going back again for the tag titles in October. Must be, like, again, I don't want to keep going on about, oh, it must be like you're leveling up, as you said, or anything, but being able to wrestle in a place where you can call home, that must be a little bit of an added bonus of being in that kind of match. I don't know what the question is. If you can figure out a question from there, that'd be great.
I mean, for me, the event being at Troon Town Hall, obviously I'm from I was born in Irvine Central, which doesn't even have a maternity ward anymore. That sort of shows my age. But I was brought up in Shrun. I went to school there, left when I was 17, but my family are all still in Shrun. Shrun Town Hall is where I had my first gig in my first band. It's where I went to Christmas dances in secondary school. So it is legitimately, with no exaggeration, an extremely special place to me. It has a very, very special spot in my heart. It's linked to some extremely significant life moments for me. So being able to go back there, calling myself a pro wrestler and having Brody beside me and representing Arcade Violence and representing Iron Girders Gym and the time that we spent at GPWA as well. It is extremely special. That being said, we are up against guys who are an established tag team, are champions for a reason. They have a size advantage, which actually in the Scottish scene for Brody and I is quite rare to be on that side of things. They also have an age advantage, which again for Brody and I is quite unusual. So it's a completely new experience for us. And for me, high emotion, and obviously Brody's not from Shrun, but from literally as close as you can be to Shrun without being in Shrun itself.
Yeah, I'm from the next town over, Prestwick, which are two towns that are pretty much attached. So I've been to gigs in the concert hall myself, and as Jake said, it would be a very special homecoming for us.
When you say that as well, it must be weird because most of the time when you're wrestling, you're not looking for any fanfare or fan favourites. You're quite comfortable getting booed and riling up a crowd, but a match like that against the Alliance, Adam Shame and Sweeney, you'll be the hometown boys. You'll be the hometown favourite. So do you block out the fans a little bit when you're wrestling when it comes to that? Do you just do the job that you are set out to do, or will emotion possibly come into play in that kind of match?
I think so Brody and I aren't really looking for any acceptance from anyone other than the people who have helped us get to this position, which is a decent sized list of people that have given us the advice and mentored us and trained us to get to this place. Beyond that, we don't need people's acceptance or support. I think that being said, Brody and I were talking about this last night. There are people who like what we do and want to see us succeed. To a certain extent, that is out of our control. But it is important that we acknowledge that those people are out there, and that it does mean a lot. And in certain situations, in certain shows, and I think the Trun one will probably fall into this category, it does make what we're doing pretty special at times. I think you would agree with that, Brody.
Yeah, for the most part, yeah. When it comes to, you know, working in Glasgow and ICW, I couldn't care less what the idiots in the crowd think. They don't mean anything to me. I don't think they mean anything to Jake. When we go back home, when we go to Trun, maybe a little bit of emotion comes in. Maybe I'm a little bit more emotional than Jake. You know, those are our people. Those are the people we grew up with. If Coach and Sweeney, you know, try and play up to them, maybe we'll react. We'll have to wait and see.
Yeah.
So that was Pro 2 through our questions, just asking. I look forward to hearing what you guys are going to say about the upcoming matches. But Pro 2 is in our company that's really on its way up, it seems, at the moment. Since the pandemic in general, it was an odd time. You guys came into wrestling at that point as actual trying to get into the business itself. So I don't know if that helped you, to be honest. Like, you immediately got one-to-one sessions with Jester and Wolfgang. And then during the rest of that time, you kind of just had to watch wrestling and study it. Did you feel that helped you? I mean, you wouldn't have known any other way at that point, but do you feel like having that one-to-one so early on, did that help you guys kind of get the basics down so you could kind of mesh them together later.
Yeah, it probably did. As pretty much with what you said, we had to do one to ones. There was no other option. And then when the rules started relaxing a bit, they would go from one to ones to two to ones. And there's a small core group of us that train together, still train together to this day with some of the other guys that are on the scene. We'll get together with a coach and we will just train for a few hours on any given day. And having smaller groups does certainly help. You can focus more on, you know, your weaknesses and things like that. Yeah.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think, like you say, Billy, like we came in not really knowing it to be any other way or having any preconceived notion of what it was going to be like. But in hindsight, looking at how it is now that that's all the COVID stuff has settled down, training in small groups is still my favourite way to train as well. I think looking back at it, we were extremely lucky to get such focused attention from coaches. But it was a weird time. It kind of felt like the industry was slightly on its knees after. I mean, there was various things, but it went through a few hard years, and then COVID was brutal for everyone and most industries really. I think iron girders played an extremely important part in keeping certain people's momentum going and in making new trainees feel like a priority and feel important in the system. I think it was big for that. I know that iron girders through the lockdown sort of relied a little bit on these new guys coming in and doing the one-to-ones. That is, at the end of the day, a business, just like everything else. So, yeah, weird time, though, thinking back to it now.
Absolutely. And you mentioned right at the start, saying people did things that they may not have thought of, like you guys thought, I'm going to try wrestling, because what's me as well at this point, I'm going to try it. Which are... I did podcasting, and that seemed to be a thing that everyone did at the same time as well. So it's just trying to find the best way to move forward. So before we move on to the rest of the questions that we got through Instagram and through Twitter, and as my desktop is popping up saying that something's not working, I hate technology. The last thing I want to bring up is you wrestled at Comic-Con, and by the sounds of it, that seems like maybe not a bucket list thing, but something that you were able to pop on the bucket list very quickly and tick it off at the same time. Is that, again, am I right in thinking that? What was it like wrestling in front of the potential, like potential hundreds, potential thousands of people that will see you wrestle that day? What was it like wrestling at ComCon?
Yeah, that was a big one for us. You know, obviously we mentioned we were both involved in music for a long time, and in a strange way, wrestling has ticked off things for me on my bucket list that I wanted to achieve through music. So performing at the Garage, and then with Comic-Con, performing at the SEC, which is in any industry is an achievement, you know. So it was a hell of a couple of days at Comic-Con. It was bizarre to walk out into the SEC and perform, but it was an incredible experience.
That was so soon after we became was that just after our debut match?
I think it was a week later, yeah.
After our debut match, I remember Brody and I walking in to the SEC with our gear in hand and stuff. And just, yeah, it was a bit of a surreal moment to go through. But yeah, that was a really special weekend, actually. But yeah, I would say it definitely was a bucket list thing. It was a lot of fun that weekend, and a really nice atmosphere.
So back onto the we'll get the Twitter questions up, and then I can finish with the Instagram ones so I can look at my phone like I'm a really old man. Westy has asked, if given the choice out of any promotion from anywhere in the world, which dream tag team would you most like to face, and what would your ideal stipulation be?
I mean, there's a couple of different answers here, so I'll give you a couple. for purely personal reasons, it would be Wolfgang and Mark Coffey. We've trained with Wolfgang enough times to know what kind of a competitor he is, but to really test ourselves against our head coach would be a hell of an honor, to be honest. I would love to go in there and give him a fight and show him who we really are, because I think the only way to find that out is by wrestling someone.
Mm-hmm.
As far as people that I like currently in wrestling, I would love to wrestle Chris Brooks and Masataka Nishi from DDT. Chris Brooks currently has the big belt over there, but he is a guy that made his career as a tag team wrestler as well, in many different promotions all over the world. I think he's a good example of where hard work in the British indie scene can take you. I've got a lot of respect for him, so I would love to wrestle him and Masataka Nishi.
Yeah, I would agree with Brody on the first one as well. I think going up against Gallus, that would be pretty special for the reasons that Brody listed. And I'll just add in the little extra of making it in a cage, just because Wolfgang in a cage would probably be the single most terrifying thing that I've gone through in my life so far. And I think after that, everything would feel like a walk in the park. So.
Did he not do that at the Hydro? Did he not have a cage match at the Hydro? I think he did. So,
so let's do that. For me, I'm actually going to go. I don't know if Westy was wanting to include, you know, tag teams from the past, but the first thing that came to mind is it's very simple and arguably a little bit basic, but give us New Age Outlaws in a ladder match, because I've always loved tag ladder matches, and they were the first tag team that I genuinely loved. Seen on television, absolutely popped for every time they appeared on my screen. So that's my second one.
I'll give you one that might be possible that we would both love. We're not the kind of guys that would, you know, tweet at people on social media or put on Instagram who we want to wrestle, but a tag team in the UK that we do want to wrestle and we think is possible is Lycos Gym.
Yeah.
Those guys are absolutely incredible. And Kid Lycos is a guy that probably doesn't get the respect he deserves in the British independent scene. So we would love to wrestle Lycos, Jim.
Yeah.
Excellent. So kind of following on from that, Gaz Williams put top five tag teams you want to face. So I would say that maybe more, I don't know, possible ones. So, I mean, New Age Outlaws, not impossible. But more of a case of, is there in Scotland, is there anyone, or England, that you want to get outside of Lycos, Jim, in the ring? Doesn't have to be five.
Number one would be Lycos Gym in the UK for me.
Yeah, and I would like to add immediately BT Gunn and Kez Evans, because they're making a habit of coming out in ICW just shortly after we've had a match and never while we are in full swing in the ring. So I'd like to examine why that's their timing. Maybe get them two on two in the ring would be nice. Never faced KOE. I would like to face KOE. I think they've been at the top of the tag team scene quite rightly for a long time. And that would also be a different experience for us, much like this match in Troon. You know, they certainly both have a size advantage on me. They're extremely capable athletes. They can do pretty remarkable stuff. So,
KOE. The Fair City Saints as well. They're guys from the other side of the country we'd like to face. We've got limited experience on the East Coast. We went over and wrestled Frank Gallo and the lads that are now calling themselves the Meat Factory.
Meat Factory.
I get mixed up because of Meat Wagon. We would like to wrestle those guys again in a straight tag team match. That was a six man.
Yep.
Like we were saying really early on, right now Scotland is very lucky when it comes to tag team wrestling, all sides of the country, north, west, east. I don't know about south. I don't know what counts as the south. But yeah, so we're very lucky that way. So we've got Judas Gray, who is asked two questions. People you want to wrestle as a team, we've already covered that one, and as singles, as you put in that as well. So a little bit different, because you guys are, as at the moment, you're a career tag team. But is there anyone that you'd want to get in with one-on-one?
I'd like to wrestle Judas Gray. I seen him wrestle at Wrestle Carnival last year. He wrestled one of the... is it Rob Stowe, his name is? Rob Stowe?
Yeah.
He wrestled him, and Judas Gray looked incredible. and I think he's doing really well for himself, and I think he's a name that is going to be appearing in a lot of promotions all over the UK over the next couple of years. I think he's absolutely superb. And I think your favourite wrestler is Aspen Faith. Am I right in saying that?
That is the rumour. Yes, it is your favourite.
I like Aspen Faith as well. I've been a fan of his for a long time. I think it'd be cool to wrestle Aspen. And I'm not opposed to deathmatch wrestling either. So I know Aspen's a man that has a bit of a history of that.
I want a match with the Wee Man because I'm sick to death of him ripping me apart on a microphone and then leaving the ring and letting the young team do his bidding. So give me the Wee Man in a lumberjack match and I choose all the lumberjacks and then we'll see how funny he is.
What a choice. Amazing. And the last question he asked was places you want to wrestle to. So you mentioned East Coast, but is there any promotions that you have your eye on, like a Wrestle Carnival or anything like that?
For sure, yeah. North for me is right near the top of the list. I think they're doing amazing stuff at the moment. Their card is always stacked, full of talent. That show they did recently where they were in a bigger venue for what I believe, and I'm sorry if this is ignorance, but what I believe was the first time in a venue that size. I just think they're doing great work. The fans that go to those shows always look like they're having the time of their lives, and it's also not that far down the road. So I would love to work in, I would love for Arcade Violence to work in North for sure.
Yeah, and Scotland Discovery is one we'd love to work for. I mean, a couple of Discovery shows over the years. A really cool company to work for. Yeah. Down south, North, TNT, Attack, all the ones that come up, but they kind of.
Solve Pro as well, who are obviously fairly new in the scene, but I think Solve Pro are doing some really, really cool stuff. So yeah, there's actually a wealth, to be honest.
Yeah. Yeah, we definitely mentioned that not only the tag team scene's coming up, but after everything that happened, pandemic and what have you, there was this lull, and it seems to really starting to pick up now with companies like Solve Pro and North doing so well, and of course Discovery being probably one of the top three companies in possibly the UK, but certainly Scotland. There's plenty of places to go, and it's just navigating the best place for Arcade Violence, I suppose, for you guys, what will showcase yourselves the best. You have listened to the show in the past, or I hope you've at least listened to one. You know what the last two questions are probably going to be before we do the old social media stuff. We ask everyone two of the most stupidest questions I've ever asked, and we've asked it from everyone from Gaz Williams to Scotty Tuhoy. What's your favourite dinosaur?
Ooh. This one. I always like the Stegosaurus. I'm thinking of the right
one. One of those?
Yeah, exactly. Yep. Because I believe that's a herbivore as well, right?
It is.
And it's just this like gentle guy that happens to have massive plates down his spine. I just think it's really... I think it's really cool. It's an iconic dinosaur. So yeah, Stegosaurus.
What's the one with the big club tail? Is that an Ankylosaurus?
I think it is. Do you think after I've asked this question about 150 times, I would know what dinosaurs are? I'm working on just very primary school level, but I think that's an Ankylosaurus.
I like that one. Yeah, but it's hunched over on the ground, quite low down, but with a big tail. Yeah, I'll go with that.
That suits you. I have images of you doing the Polish hammer.
There we go.
And the last question we ask is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Two sheep.
I was going to go for the cow.
Controversial. Any workings with that, or you just gut feeling?
I just think they're both pretty awkward animals, but I think a cow is pretty awkward with its manoeuvrability, and I think the sheep would sort of run circles around it a wee bit, just like not legs and stuff.
If we could get the cow to the top of a hill and it gets some speed, I think it's over. I think it's going through the sheep.
Oh, I love this question. It never gets boring. But perfect. I think we've covered quite a lot of Arcade Violence history, and I'm sure in the future we'll get you back on when you've got some belts as well. Could be by the end of the year. So fingers crossed. But thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me today. Plug your social media. Who wants to plug all their links?
Yeah, you go first, Brody. You're better at it than I am.
Yeah, best place to catch us is on Instagram. It's certainly where we're the most active. I am Turnbull PW. And what are you, Lawless?
I'm Lawless _ wrestler, I believe. And on Twitter or X, if you want to call it that, I believe it's without the underscore. It's just Lawless Wrestler. But I am on Twitter and I share and repost the right stuff, but I'm not very active on there. I don't think it's a particularly healthy place. So way more active on Instagram. We've got good content on there. You'll always hear about the matches. You'll see the content that we put out pretty regularly. So yeah, that'd be the best place.
Yeah, Instagram's the best place to find us.
Yeah, Twitter's horrible. It's a wretched hive of scum and villainy and only place that I'm fairly active in. But anyway, yeah, thank you very much for speaking to me today. Looking forward to seeing what you guys do. And by the time this episode comes out, like I say, you could be champions. You mean you're on your way to that match with the Alliance, so who knows? But yeah, thanks again.
We'll see you, man. Thanks, really appreciate it.
Thanks for having us.